This presentation is brought to you by Arizona State University's Julianne Wrigley Global Institute of Sustainability and a generous investment by Julianne Wrigley.
I've come at the issues of our time in the role of a communicator. I never even played a scientist on TV. I'm not a scientist. I'm not an engineer. I've spent close to 30 years talking to hundreds of scientists and engineers and looking at issues that matter, like climate change, the role of agrochemicals. One of the first stories I did in the early 80s was about on the environment was about a pesticide called paraquat that was a great new tool in this kind of agriculture called no-till agriculture, which has all kinds of benefits, but there were side effects. Paraquat was poisoning thousands of people a year in developing countries who drank it accidentally. It's a brown liquid. They would store it in Coke bottles, and that's a bad combination. So I've been like going at it, though, from those standpoints, but And with climate change, which I've been writing about since the mid-1980s, I spent the first 15 years exploring climate as a biogeophysical problem. Emissions are rising. These are the possible consequences. These are the possible secondary consequences for nature and for things that matter, like water supplies. And it was only the last 5 or 10 years I really started to home in on an element I hadn't really considered, which was the element I've been using personally to explore all these questions, which is my mind, the human mind. And on my blog, the reason I started .earth more than 3 years ago was after several decades of conventional journalism, of talking to people, trying to get a sense of, okay, this is what we know, put that in a paper or a magazine or in a documentary a couple of times. There, I was always searching for definitiveness. And with journalism generally, there's sort of a faux sense often of definitiveness, of clarity. The New York Times front page is black and white. But actually, when you look, stand back from it, it's really gray, you know, if you can't see the individual letters. And I began to realize, in the last few years, that if I'm not examining, not just being a journalist, if I'm not looking at the whole pipeline, how information matters or doesn't matter, how people absorb knowledge or reject it based on predispositions, that I'm not really going to get traction. And that means I've dived into this very ugly arena of cultural cognition. There's a website, I encourage you to write down culturalcognition.net, one phrase, which is a place where researchers led by Dan Kahane at Yale are exploring these boxes that we're in, durable silos, really, where if you're in one, you're going to go out there and reject anything that sounds like global warming from human activities is a dangerous thing. And if you're in the other, at the other end of the spectrum, you're going to actively embrace anything about the weather that seems to fit in a marginal way that we're heading into a catastrophe, and you're going to reject anything that gets at the durable uncertainties about climate. And so that's what led me also to shift from conventional journalism to a new role where I'm still writing for the New York Times in an interrogatory way every day. I'm not telling you, most of the time on .earth, I'm not saying what I think. I'm asking questions, like I did yesterday about Egypt's uprising. And I mused on, I said, basically, this is a great moment to examine some of these issues. Look through the last few days or week of speculation on what triggered the uprising in Egypt. And you can find, essentially, everyone with an agenda found a lesson in the Egypt uprising. It was about poverty. It was about a dictatorship. It was about global warming, if you're climate progress. It was about food insecurity. And I said, I raised the point that it's probably at least partially about technology, about the fact that if you want to collaborate and coordinate massive demonstrations today through texting and cell phones, you have this incredible real-time ability to sort of get a lot of people to do something at the same time or to think about something. I want to show you very quickly a couple images. One thing that we need at this time is new ways of thinking about information. You can't see this very well, but if you go on the blog, it's been there a few times. There's a British illustrator named Adam Neiman, N-I-E-M-A-N, created these portrayals of Earth's liquid and atmospheric resources, where he took the actual known volume of the world's oceans and fresh waters and made it into a sphere. And so that little green bubble on the left there is all of the world's liquid water. You know, and I've sailed across two oceans when I was young, younger, I know how big the oceans are, and it's amazing to be in the middle of the Indian Ocean, 1,000 miles from land, with 2 miles deep of water underneath you, and it feels utterly beyond measurement. But then when you actually put it into a ball, it's really small. So I think that's an interesting way to captivate it and galvanize a discussion of anything related to water resources. You look at that. By the way, you can't even see the freshwater. If you put the freshwater into a sphere at that scale, you wouldn't see it. The one on the right, the pink bubble, is all the atmosphere. If at sea level pressure, if you took all the air in the atmosphere, put it in a volume at sea level pressure, that's the global commons. That's what we have to parse out to 9 billion people in a few decades in terms of who has the right to pollute or not pollute, or, and especially with greenhouse gases, that's a big issue. So there's a new way of thinking and having discourse about climate, energy, water resources that comes from a new way of measuring and conveying knowledge, which is a great thing. And you know, these images will be so dark that I won't even go there. This picture says something that I think you can see. This is three pie charts. You can see the dark area, which is red. This is who has cell phones in the world. And in at the left, it's 2,000. The overall dimensions of the pie are the total number of cell phones. It was 700 million cell phones in 2000. 2 billion in 2005. And as you can see, by 2005, it's essentially roughly 50-50, rich countries and poor countries. Now it's 3/4 of the world's 5 billion cell phones are in developing countries. 3/4 of the world's cell phones, 5 billion cell phones, and we'll be up to having more cell phones than there are people in a few years, are in developing countries. To me, that says very powerfully that discourse is the opportunity for both learning and shaping knowledge and spreading ideas is explosively growing. That means we're at a great moment in our history. We have this, there's been this talk of noosphere. This is the idea of the planet of the mind for generations. There was a French theologian and a Russian geochemist in the 30s who came up with this idea of information will be this sort of global resource a long time ago. And now we're kind of inching toward having that potential. But as Brad said, we also have to look inward and see, it's not just about sharing information, it's about self-recognition. How do we, facing complicated problems, like how to minimize conflict on a crowding planet, how to minimize risks of contributing to long-lasting global warming and sea level rise, those, if we don't look inward and recognize how we as human beings, for the moment, have limited capacity to deal with some kinds of problems with the wicked and even super wicked qualities that Brad alluded to, we're not going to get there from here. And one thing I love about Brad's title here is it's engineering and ethics, which means you can't really move forward with one or the other in this century. I wrote on my blog today that each of those things alone is insufficient. If we all take on the attributes of the Dalai Lama, and who's an omnivore, by the way, he's not a vegetarian, and the attributes of Lester Brown, and we're still 9 billion people seeking decent lives, you can't get there from here without technology. But technology alone is insufficient as well, without some new sense of values on how to share those bubbles that I showed you a few minutes ago. So that's a good place to stop and now start to ponder some things.
This presentation is brought to you by Arizona State University's Julianne Wrigley Global Institute of Sustainability for educational and non-commercial use only.